Phillips one time were members of our church visiting with us from Columbia. Glad to have you all with us also. And others, as I said a while ago. Verse number 24 in Matthew chapter 13. Now, last Sunday, I tried to bring you a message on the parable of the sower that we find in Matthew 13, beginning with verse number 1. And I tried to show you what the parable taught. And in fact, I gave the interpretation as I find it recorded in chapter 13, beginning with verse number 16 and 17. Very interesting thing about these seven parables in Matthew 13. All seven of them are given by our Lord, but only the first two are interpreted by our Lord. And that means the last five, we have to compare Scripture with Scripture and come up with our own interpretation of the last five of the parables. And I think they're not too difficult. I think the interpretation we usually give is correct. The footnotes in the Scofield Bible are very profitable about the interpretation of these parables. Now, they are important because they are related to the age of the church. Anything in the Bible that relates itself to the age of the church is very important Scripture. For example, the seven letters in Revelation 2 and 3 are related to the dispensation of the church. Ephesus, the church of the apostles, and Smyrna, the church crushed in persecution, and Pergamos, and Thyatira, and Sardis, and Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And those churches in chronological order, those letters in Revelation 2 and 3, is a pre-written history in prophecy in relation to the age of the church. Now, to tell you the truth about it, we that are part of the church, and when I speak of the church, I'm talking about the local assembly, and I'm talking about the born-again body, we don't have a great deal to worry about the church as far as its posterity and its prosperity is concerned, because it's in good hands. And not only is the church prophesied in the Bible, but it's described in the Bible, and then the consummation of it is spelled out in the Scriptures as well. And so it's going to run the course as God ordained and prophesied that it would. And the church does and has and will accomplish exactly the purpose God designed and placed it into the world to accomplish. You need not fret about that. Government can't stop it. No government can stop it. Communism cannot stop it. Liberalism cannot stop the church. Worldly indifference cannot stop the church. Nothing. The church is going to move on the pre-prophesied schedule. And the schedule is set up and set forth in Revelation 2 and 3 and also in Matthew chapter 13. And I'm going to deal with the second of these parables today, beginning with verse number 24 in chapter 13. I suggested to you last week, and I'm going to suggest it again, when you have the time, sit down with your Bible and lay these seven parables down, beginning with the first one, right straight through to number 7, and right on top of these seven parables, place the seven letters to the churches in Revelation 2 and 3, and then look for the similarity between them in chronological order. Now, if you violate the order, then you destroy all the typology and all the prophecy involved. But if you'll take them in the order given in the Bible, they speak volumes in relation to the kingdom of heaven is called in these parables. And the kingdom of heaven, to me, is synonymous with the age of the church and also has to do with the millennium that is going to come out yonder when the church is raptured out. The kingdom of heaven is not the kingdom of God. The two terms are not to be used interchangeably. The kingdom of heaven is earthly and temporal. The kingdom of God is heavenly and eternal. And you can't mix them. If you mix them, you're going to run into trouble. And they're not used interchangeably in the Bible. One or two places they seem to be, but that's a fault of our interpretation, not a fault of the Bible. They are two different and separate things as far as I'm concerned. Now, I'm aware of the fact that good Bible teachers say that they are synonymous and they speak of the same thing. I'm aware of that fact. But I beg to differ. I believe that there is a difference, as the Scofield Bible sets it forth in the footnotes. I agree with the Scofield Bible footnotes in relation to the kingdom of heaven. The last six of these parables begin with that same terminology, the kingdom of heaven, it likened to. Now look at verse 24. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and afterwards sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder, the man of verse number 24, is the householder of verse 27, said to him, sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? And the answer is supposed to be, yes, sir. All gospel seed is good seed. If that be so, then question 2 in verse 27, from which then hath it tears? Why do you find the tears if you sowed good seed? Now the workers evidently did not know that the enemy had done it. They just supposed that the householder had made a mistake and sowed tears among the among the wheat. And in that degree, the seed sown was not good seed. But I submit to you that all the gospel seed is good seed. But from which then hath it tears? And the householder said to them, an enemy hath done this. And the enemy, of course, is the devil. And the servant said unto him, wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? That is, root out the tears? And the householder was a wise man, evidently, with a great deal of knowledge about agriculture and planting and producing. And he wisely said, no, nay, lest while you gather up the tears, ye root up also the wheat with them. And then yet another wise statement in verse 30, let them, tares and wheat, both grow together until the harvest. Which is to say, there's going to come a time when they shall be indeed a separating. But in the meantime, let them both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, not at the harvest proper. The harvest proper will be rather swiftly when the wicked will be severed from the just. It'll be a rather swift thing. But in the time of the harvest, I will say to my reapers, gather ye together first the tears. Before there can be a final harvesting, there must be a gathering together, a binding together, an abundant together of the tears. And that starts in the time of the harvest. You know, a great and profound historical facts do not happen overnight. Nothing happens overnight except a catastrophe or some terrible flood or storm or something like that, an act of God. All that happens worthwhile takes a great deal of time, a great deal of development. You take the Protestant Reformation, for example. The Protestant Reformation broke the back of the Roman Catholic Church in 1517, and the fuse was ignited by a man named Martin Luther, who was a Roman Catholic priest, and who was excommunicated by the Catholic Church because of his dissent and because of his objections to the sale of indulgences and to the corruption that prevailed in the papacy. Now, if you have the idea that Luther is the sole responsibility for the Protestant Reformation, you're dead wrong. 100 years before Luther was born, there was a man named John Knox, John Huss, 100 years, who died at a fiery stake, put to death by the Inquisitors in 1415. That's 100 years before the Protestant Reformation. He taught the same thing. At his side was Jerome of Prague, another dissident. Another who was objecting to the sale of indulgences and other things that was being done by the established church of that day. He also died a year after John Huss died. So did Jerome die, and many others. To tell you the truth, the Protestant Reformation had its seed in the Inquisition. And the Inquisition was set up by the established church in 1220 A.D., which is 300 years before Luther. And in 300 years, from 1220 down to 1517, the seed of the Protestant Reformation was sown in Europe and in Germany. And all that Luther did was to strike the match and light the fuse, so to speak. It had been seething. It had been producing. It had been building up slowly but surely for at least 300 years before Luther came on the scene. And so it is with the matter of the tears. Down through all the years of the church, we've had tears among the wheat. And the wise householder said, let them both grow together. And in the time of the harvest, not at the harvest, but in the time of the harvest, I will begin a process of separating and binding and bundling the tares to burn them, but then gather the wheat into the barn. Now, the interpretation of that parable. What is the Lord saying in this great parable given in Matthew 13? All 7 of them related to the kingdom of heaven, therefore related to the age of the church. The parable of the sower is Jesus, who went out to sow good seed. He's the first and the original sower. We do the same thing when we sow the seed in our day, but not in the same degree that the Savior, who that sower begins with a capital S. My sowing begins with a little S. It's not nearly important, but we do that. And then following the day of the apostles and the day of our Lord, you have the parable given of the tares among the wheat. And you're not far away from Calvary until the tares begin to appear. The first sign of doctrinal corruption in the history of the church begins to emerge in Alexander, Egypt. Well, actually, I think I'd go further back than that. I could say that it begins to emerge in Galatians chapter number 1, and that's in the lifetime of the Apostle Paul. But that was stopped by the Jerusalem Council, as recorded in Acts chapter 15. But about 250 A.D. in Alexander, Egypt, you find some pagan practices and ceremonies beginning to creep into the established church, church of that day. And that was before the Catholic Church was born, and there was no organized Baptist church of that day, or no Methodist church, no Presbyterian church. None of the Protestant church existed until after 1517. But the organized church, the Catholic Church, was born at 325 A.D. And by the time you get to 325, you have infant baptism. By that time already beginning to be practiced. The seed had already been sown. And the records tell us in history that infant baptism had its origin about 370 A.D. And then by the time you get to 600 A.D., under the Pope Innocent III, there was no baptism by immersion in the organized established church. By that time, all of it was by sprinkling. But in the New Testament, not one verse suggesting that the mode of baptism is sprinkling and that infants ought to be baptized. Not one verse. Slowly it crept into the church, and so these things began to appear. The tears were being sown and had been sown early in the age of the church. And down through the years, the devil is into it that even yet the tears are being sown among the wheat. Now the Lord gives the interpretation in verse 36 of chapter number 13. And let's examine this, the interpretation of this parable given by the Lord. He can handle it far better than I can, that's for sure. Then Jesus sent the multitude away. And that's an interesting thing to me. He gave the first four parables to the multitudes. And the four in the Bible is a number of the earth. That means that the people were of the earth. Anybody that wanted to listen at him, he spoke the first four parables to the multitudes. Both saved and unsaved, both Jew and Gentile, anybody. But when finally parable number 4, that of the 11, was given, Jesus sent the multitude away and took his own 12, his immediate disciples. It says in verse number 36, they came to him and said to the Lord, declare unto us, explain unto us the parable of the tears in the field. And so he gave the interpretation only to the 12. He gave the parable to the multitude. He gave four parables to the multitude. But he gave the interpretation of parable number 2 only to the 12, and then the last three parables were given only to the 12, his immediate disciples. That always interests me when I note that difference in verse 36. In verse 37, Jesus answered and said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. Now that was so in the parable of the sower, number 1 in this chapter. He that sowed the good seed is the Son of Man, and the Son of Man is the Lord Jesus. Now, we're told that the field is the world. Now, I didn't say that. That's what the Lord said. And I read about the field into which the enemy has sown the tears in parable number 2. That means that throughout all the world of that day or in any day, the devil is going to be busy sowing tears among the wheat, sowing discord among the brethren, sowing doctrinal corruption among the pure in doctrine, you see. That's the business of the devil. He's a corrupter. He is a deceiver. And he sows the seed of the tears, which could not be called good seed. Not at all. Even the servants of the householder knew that. And they thought the householder had made a mistake. And they said, let us go out and root up those tears out of the field. You made a mistake and sowed them. But he did not make a mistake. In fact, he didn't sow them. We'll see that in the next verse. The field is the world. And we're told in verse number 38, and the good seed, now watch this difference, are the children of the kingdom. The sower, the original sower in parable number 1, is the Son of Man. But the sower in parable number 2 is the children of the kingdom, children of God, the born again. We are the sower in parable number 2. Jesus is the sower in parable number 1. And the seed sown in parable number 1 is the gospel. But the seed in parable number 2 is the witness and the testimony of the children of the kingdom. And that makes your witness in mind all the more important. Someone has said the only gospel some people know is the gospel of your life and mine. The only testimony many people ever hear is your life and mine. The best sermon you shall ever preach is the sermon of your life. When you live it, and as you live it day by day, You give a witness to the good grace of God. And that's God's plan. God worked it that way. And we're clearly told in verse 38 that the good seed, in parable number 2, are the children of the kingdom, but the tears are the children of the wicked one. Like a football game out on the battlefield, you have two opposing teams on the gridiron, we say. And each one of those opposing teams wants to win the game over the other. And they'll go to almost any limit to win that game. They are rough in their attempt to get that ball across the goal line and become the winner. And they are opposed one to another. And they study how to win. Well, in the gospel world, we're like that gridiron. We that are children of the good seed, the children of the kingdom. So the good seed, the gospel. But against us, the children of the wicked one are sowing the tears. And as fast as I can cast out a handful of good seed, the devil's going to come right along and with his children cast out a handful of tears sown among the wheat. Now the enemy in verse 39, the enemy that sowed these tears is the devil. Make no mistake about that. The origin of the tears among the wheat is the devil. The origin of the good seed, of course, is the original sower, who is our Lord Jesus Christ. But the devil is going to counteract everything we do. He's going to counterfeit everything we do. God has the children of the kingdom. The devil has the children of the night, the children of his kingdom. Righteousness prevails in the life of God's people who are born again. Ungodliness prevails in the life of those who are not born again. God is pressing on to sow the seed, and the enemy is pressing against the church as we attempt to sow the seed. The battle is on. No way to avoid it. Now you become neutral. In our day, it's rather popular to become neutral. It's rather popular to become passive. Right. And not many people are willing to stand for this book. Now just to face up to it. Not many are willing to face the responsibility of taking a definite stand for the Lord. You'd be surprised how many churches, I mean a local assembly, just won't take a stand. They won't take a stand against the world. And they'll not take a stand against sin. And they'll not take a stand against liberalism and modernism. I would not have to leave Greenville County to find churches in every denomination that are passive and neutral. They don't want to offend anybody. They won't take a stand. Now, that's tragic. That's not that we are trying to stir up a fight at Tabernacle or any other church that will take a stand. I don't necessarily enjoy fighting. I'd much rather rejoice. I'd much rather shout the victory. But there comes a time when we have to draw the line and say, now, you don't cross that line. And if you cross that line, you're going to hear from me. And I can't but speak. I cannot help but speak, you see. Now we have to stand. I received a magazine from a fundamentalist, so-called. Well, I know the man that edits the magazine is a fundamentalist, and I'm not calling the names. The magazine's in my office. I'll let you see it. I think I mentioned this Wednesday night. You can read it for yourself if you'd like. But it came to my desk this week, and there was an article in that magazine on fanatical fundamentalists. And in that article, my eye was attracted to a paragraph that said something like this. And I'm not quoting verbatim, but almost verbatim. He said, these preachers who are loud and emotional in their preaching and who denounce the papacy, the Church of Rome, lack Christian love in so doing. If you denounce the papacy as an instrument of Antichrist, that article said, you lack the love of Christ, which was a pretty heavy rebuke to me and a lot of other preachers that preach like I preach. Now, all my lifetime, I've been preaching that the papacy is the program of the Antichrist. I don't think Christ fits into that picture, or the New Testament fits into that picture in the least. And I'm too bold now to try to change my doctrine at that particular point. And I think I have no right nor reason to change it. So regardless of what that article might have said from a fundamentalist, what I'm concerned, it certainly is not a lack of the love of Christ when you stand for truth. Not at all. And by the grace of God, we're just going to stand there for truth. And if it has to have a fight to hold up the standard of truth, then we'll just have to have the fight. I don't welcome that. I don't encourage that. I'd rather not. But I'm not going to run from it. And I'm not going to water my preaching down and become passive and sweet and neutral. There's some folks that I just can't walk with in the Christian world. Now, if that's treason, you make the most of it. They say that we're saved. I have a letter from a priest from up in Maine last week. I think I mentioned this Wednesday night. And that priest dressed me down for my sermon that he read in the Soul of the Lord last week. That was a fact. And I didn't bother to answer the letter. He took the time to dress me down, a priest, and signed his name Father So-and-so. But I didn't bother to answer the letter. I just threw it in the trash can. Well, as I'm concerned, he can paddle his own canoe. I'm not on his team. I couldn't fellowship with a man like that. No way. Oh, but preacher, you need to become ecumenical. You need to get in this great movement propagated by PTL and Club 700 to get everybody together. And propagated by the National Council of Churches to get everybody together. To build a great super church. My soul, I'm not in that. I'm a non-union Baptist preacher. If that's treason, you make the most of it. I'm not joining up with anybody unless they teach the truth. You know, when I began preaching in Greenville a long time ago, I watched them all come and go. I don't know why God let me hang around here so long. Were it not for my good people, and I have the best people in the world. The very fact that you've endured me 33 years is an indication of that. Nobody could deny that. And I appreciate my people. But I didn't dream when I was a young preacher, 25 years old, that the day would come when I'd be the oldest pastor in this area, actively pastoring a congregation of people. But I've reached that point, and as far as I know, I'm it. I don't know that anything to be proud of. I've got one foot in the grave. That's what it cost me to be it. I wish I could back up and run back about 20 years and get away from that grave, but I can't do that. So I'm elected. I'm it. But it took my life to get it. But in all these years, and this is what I started to say, I have never attended one Greenville Ministerial Union meeting. And I don't plan to start. How can I sit down with men that don't believe the Bible? And some of the group in the union don't believe the Bible. And so I've avoided the Greenville Ministerial Union. Though I pastor one of the largest churches in the state and the longest ministry, I'm not part of that group. Oh, you're a rabble-rouser. Now, you help yourself. My hide is pretty well hardened by this moment, and you're not going to hurt me. I just can't sit down with a man that don't believe the Bible. Whether he's a Baptist, a Pentecostal, or what have you. If he doesn't believe the Bible, we're going down two different roads.
Amen.
And those roads never meet. Those roads never meet. They get further and further away.
Amen.
Apart. They never meet. I'm a dissident. I'm a dissenter. I'm a Baptist. And I cannot sit down with men that don't believe the Bible, like Baptists believe it. Well, for the sake of unity. No, not even for the sake of unity. Well, you had a Sunday school lesson about it today. That kind of unity I've had since God saved me many years ago. But the ecclesiastical unity of our day is not taught in the Bible. In fact, the Bible forbids me to do it. Does not the Bible say, if any man bring any other gospel unto you than that which we have delivered, let him be accursed?
Yes.
Galatians 1. It says that not one time, but twice. And you can't put your arm around anything that goes. You just can't do that and have the blessing of God upon you. And churches cannot do that. Tabernacle cannot do that. And you people believe in the fundamental truths of the Bible as much as your pastor does. And there'd be no way that we could put our support, our prayer support, our financial support in any kind of a missionary or program or any kind of a local program that doesn't measure to this book. This is our guideline. This is our book. These are our marching orders. And I cannot obey any orders that I don't find in the book, nor can I companion or associate with people who do not believe this book. Nor can I pray for people who do not believe this book. And I'm certainly not going to give them my endorsement by joining up with them, you see. Now, the enemy is the enemy of the gospel, the enemy of the church, the enemy of the souls of men, the enemy is the devil, just a pure old devil. Lucifer is his name. And Jesus said, the enemy that sold them is the devil. Not a sweet little demon, but the devil. That word demon is not found in your Bible, by the way. No one ever hear anybody tabernacle say demon. You say what the Bible says, devil, D-E-V-I-L. You can't pronounce that demon. That's spelled devil and pronounced devil. And that's the man that put the tares in the field. That's the rascal. That's the enemy that put the tares in the field. The devil. The devil is the enemy of God, and the seed of the devil is the enemy of the seed of the gospel. And the program of the devil is directly opposed to the program of God. You can never get them together. No way. No way. Don't you try to get them together. Now, we're told in verse 39 that the harvest is the end of the age. The word world is aeon, the end of the age of the church. The harvest is at the end of the world, or the end of the age of the church in which we now live. And the reapers are the angels. Isn't that interesting that God is going to allow the angels to become involved in the process of binding and bundling the tares at the time of the harvest? Not at the harvest, but at the time of the harvest. The only thing that's going to happen at the time of the harvest is separating the tares from the wheat and casting the bundle of tares into a furnace of fire. But the time of the harvest could be a period of time of several years, during which time the tares are going to get together, become bound together in the ministry of the angels. God knows what man's going to do, and so he's going to allow the angels to superintend the binding of the tares and the burning of the tares. The angels, the reapers rather, are the angels in verse number 39. I think preachers and pastors will be involved in a way, because we warn people of the damage of the tares. We warn people to be faithful to the good seed, the gospel. In a sense, we have a hand in it. But in the final analyses, the separating and the binding is to be done by the angels. You don't see the angels, but they're working. I've never seen an angel. You've never seen an angel. But they're in this earth, and they're ministering spirits. And they're faithful to God. And the process of binding the tears, I believe, is going on right now. Well, how do you say that, preacher? How do you know that? I wouldn't be at all surprised if the ecumenical movement, is not the process of binding the tears for the burning. Now, as far as I know, there are no Bible-believing fundamentalists in the ecumenical movement. As far as I know. I know a few men who claim to be evangelical. I mean, by that, they claim to preach the gospel and baptize converts by immersion, who are in the ecumenical movement. But I could not name one Bible-believing fundamentalist who believes in the premillennial second coming of our Lord and takes a clear stand for the gospel involved in the ecumenical movement. As far as I've been able to discern, the ecumenical movement is fostered and propagated and promoted by those who say, Lord, Lord, who've never known God and who are ecumenists, who are tares among the wheat. They have religion like the Pharisees and Sadducees. They have religion like the foolish virgins, but they don't have the Spirit. They don't know the truth. And they're out here building a world church. I think I told you that I received a box from the Mooney organization, the Unification Church, they call themselves. And when I saw where it was from, I wrote on the label, draw an arrow and pointed the arrow to the return address, and I wrote, return to sender. And I put it back in the mail and let them pay the postage on it. But somebody opened up one of them, and there was several cassette, video cassettes. Those things were quite expensive, about $15 a piece. And there were three books, I understand, and you don't print any kind of a book except at great expense. Well, what they're doing, the Mooney organization is trying to unite all the Protestant world into one great church. And the head of the church, the Unification Church, is in jail right now for not paying his income taxes. Right. But he has said that he is God's ordained leader. Bring all the people in the Christian world together in one great unified church. Well, I'd like to serve notice on him. You'll never get it done. First place, he can't handle the Jews. And then in the second place, he certainly can't handle Baptists, that's for sure. We've had that proposition made to us a lot of times. And we haven't bit yet. We're not going to bite now. We're not about to get involved in his unification movement, not at all. What I'm saying, he's a false prophet. And you'd have nothing to do with that kind of a thing, not even to pray for him or bid him Godspeed. Now, I think that kind of a thing, the angels are superintending and watching, and the process of binding the tears together. You remember the servant said, let us go out and we'll dig them up. One by one, we'll pluck them up. But the householder said, that's not the way. That's not the best way. Let them both go together. And at a certain time, he called the time of the harvest. Maybe 100 years before the harvest, or maybe 10 years before the harvest itself. But in the time of the harvest, I'll have the angels get all that crowd together, and we'll bind them up, and they're binding them up with a cord they call charity and charisma.